Can we say that one more time? I'd like to hear that one more time. Can we say, can I see you? I'll see you.
Friends, welcome to this special time. And on behalf of the family, I do ask that you would silence your cell phones and not take any pictures during the service or in this space after it finishes. We're gathered for a memorial service and to celebrate the life and music of Leon Russell, musician, songwriter, arranger, producer, rock and roll Hall of Famer, loving husband, father, and friend. Loved by those of us who are gathered here and by millions across the world. So to begin, I thought I would use the lyrics of one of the most famous songs of all time. A song so famous that I'm sure you know it, though it doesn't have a title, it just has a number. 23. It's in the Bible's Book of Songs, or Psalms. Listen for these words of comfort from the 23rd Psalm. Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. As far as we know, this came from a shepherd, a boy named David, who, like most songwriters when he wrote it, probably didn't know what he'd done. He didn't go home and tell Michael, his wife, say, hey, I wrote the 23rd Psalm today. He didn't know. He just had to put down the song that was in him. And we are probably pretty confident that if he had gone home and said that to his wife, she would have said, that's great, huh? Now go kill something with that little sling of yours and let's have dinner. Because we don't know how big the things that we do are. We just have to write to the songs that are in us. Songwriters, musicians, they're amazing. But if the gauge is how many people sing your songs, how many people use your songs and your music as the soundtrack of their lives, then we know that the psalm writer for this song did something amazing. And we also celebrate that Leon has done something remarkable. The influence is clear. Sounded like no other, wrote like no other, but many have written and sounded like him since. And for that, we are gathered here to give thanks to God for a man and music. And it's music. They can't be separated from the man or the man from the music. And so we'll celebrate today and we'll give thanks. And giving thanks, let us begin with a word of prayer. Let us pray together. God, we give you thanks for those who have written the songs that shape our lives, and we give you thanks for this musician, this artist, this beautiful soul, Leon Russell, for the music that has shaped our lives, for the faithfulness he had to the music that you gave him. And to those songs, to those lives that transcend our moments and that point us to that life beyond death, we not only give thanks, but we ask for your presence. And we ask that you would be here with us. For we are gathered to listen not just for the music, but for your voice that says, peace, be still, and that we know that we are not alone. For we are together, and you are with us through the valley of a shadow and to the light beyond. And for that we celebrate and give thanks. Amen. Let us celebrate now.
Amen. My life and time. I've sung a lot of songs. I've made some bad rhymes. Act out my life on stages with 10,000 people watching. We're alone now. And I'm singing this song for you. Long ago, so before the second show, your guitar, it sounds so sweet and clear. Yes, it did. But it's just my radio. Oh, no. And you're not really here. Don't you remember you told me you love me, baby? Said you'd be coming back to get me, baby. Don't you remember?
Fly away. Oh, fly away. Oh, 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 o when I die. Hallelujah, hallelujah, by and by. Yes, I'll fly away. This is for you, Leon. Fly. So fly, Leon, spread your wings and fly. Yes, I'll go on and fly away. Oh,
did this song all the time, and it was one of his favorites. It's always one of my favorites. I figured I ought to learn it, so I learned it yesterday. Clouds are far behind me. Where troubles melt like lemon drops, way above the chimney tops. That's where you found me. Somewhere over the rainbow, up in the sky. All the little bluebirds fly over the rainbow. Why, then, oh why? Tell me why, then, oh why? Why, then, oh why? Can I?
I just want to say a few words. Leon really touched everybody in this room, and he really touched me. He really nurtured me. I met him when I was about, I gotta say, 11, and he taught me how to write music and taught me a lot. And I remember always asking him, you know, when I was young, and he always, you know, everybody who knew him knew how humble he was. It's probably the one of the most humble men I ever met in my life. And I was asking him, you know, hey, how do you write like that, man? And he used to say, oh, you know, I steal from the best. That's what he used to say. Every time I'd ask him, I steal from the best. So I'm going to play a song. I stole from the best. I wake up to forever and it feels like it's the past. Life is just a mirror with some bends and a broken glass. The clock is always ticking, but our sense of change is thin until a picture is created from the wrinkles on our skin. I wish I knew a way to stop the time just for a minute. It's hard for me to say this, but I might as well admit it. I'm afraid that I can't love no more, 'cause I'm afraid to see my loved ones go. I try to keep my grip on tomorrow. I try to loosen up on my sorrow. I wish the end could be so much clearer. I wish that I didn't have no fear, but everything's bound to get better. He told me, you ain't gotta worry, times will get less lonely. Everything's bound to get better. He told me, you ain't gotta worry, times will get less lonely. At Jamie's funeral, I asked the Lord why did he put me in a place where everyone I love is gonna end up dying. Even before I'm 28, sometimes I wish I died with them so I wouldn't feel more pain. I called my uncle on the phone and I rang out my thoughts. He told me, son, you can't unring the bell, so just enjoy the times you haven't lost. Everything's bound to get better. ain't gotta worry. Times will get less lonely, 'cause wherever we are, just know the light will shine so bright on you. You, we are here beside you, but you just can't see until you do. And we're together in the light, together in the light, singing. Everything's bound to get better, I told you. You ain't got a word. Times are now less long. Everything's bound to get better, I told you. You ain't got a word. Times are now less lonely.
Thank you.
Life with Leon, Volume 6. My Hawaiian shirt. This is what I need handy, I know. I'm a recording engineer, I know how to run this. I've been fired as a recording engineer. I learned a great deal from Leon, including the inclination to steer completely clear of public speaking. This is gonna be hard. On a couple of occasions, including his induction into the Oklahoma Music Hall of Fame, he made me give his speeches. But here I am, thank you, honored to have a go at it. And the truth is, I talk about Leon to almost anybody that listen for hours regularly. So getting me to shut up may be the problem if I get going. I first discovered Leon as a kid by looking past just who was singing on those records, those 45s mainly, and starting to look at producer and writer credits. And I was a little late to the game. I grew up on a farm outside of Tulsa, so the Tulsa guys knew all about Leon. I was just discovering him through that. And then I saw where I was going to college at OSU in Stillwater, a little poster about the Mad Dogs in Englishman tour in Tulsa, the Brady, what now the Brady. And it was the life-changing event that I have never recovered from. Still, I suppose, the best band I ever heard, the best show I ever saw. Multiple drummers, guitar players, too many singers to really fit on the stage. Horns, yeah, Jim says horn. Kids and dogs. Joe Cocker doing some sort of magic crazy man singing. Leon, I'm not the guy who will play you my new song. We were at the church years later, and you know, we were going to write a song, and he said, "Well, sing this." And I go, "Ah." And he goes, "What's all this about?" He said, "Well, you need to always do that," he says. I can't tell you. So this stuff going on in front of my eyes, the farm boy from outside of Tulsa, and Leon as the full tilt circus ringmaster, top hat and all, with the circus that you wanted to run away from home and join. And he was from Tulsa. And oddly enough, I know this is weird, that was the night in my myth building anyway, that I realized he was from Tulsa. It was such a sledgehammer, a wonderful sledgehammer smash in the head for me. And I never, and to be fair, so I, you know, effectively stalked him, I guess. I mean, I still am a fan, coming from the word fanatic. As Leon said to me the first time I ever heard anybody say it, I don't think he was talking about me at that moment, I'm not sure, but, you know, the lunatic fringe, I think, just right on the edge. I devoured those records. That Hank Wilson record came out, the Hank Wilson persona, and it hit me. I mean, I'm a farm boy, but all of the records did, and slightly odd, quirky songs and production, and then mixed with instant classics or standards, as he liked to call them. I mean, that's true. And he wrote, I mean, who writes standards? He said, "I'm going to write a standard," and then he does. Always the Tulsa groove that, you know, I tried to be hard to become a part of. And most of his records had those amazingly Tulsa grooved up Bob Dylan covers. So, you know, Bob was also a hero of mine. Now, in that time period, early 70s, let's say, by then, there was a lot of nonsense on the radio, but also some really, really great records. And I think of Elton's records and Stevie Wonder records, and they just put out fantastic record after record after record. And those Leon records, and like the Beatles, you know, he didn't ever say this to me, but, you know, in some case with the Beatles' help, some of the Beatles, he changed things up. He reinvented himself, and I think I was attracted to that always. Now I know, looking back and after decades of being with him, he was just calling on all those influences that he had, which were many. Somewhere around 72, well, I used to know this stuff, I'm in a daze. Leon moved back to Tulsa one more time and changed an old church into a studio, the Shelter Church Studio. I used to drive by, oh, you know, I want to say every day, but I drove by now and then just hoping to get a glimpse of Leon or Cale, you know, walking down the steps, walking to the car. Little did I know what was the future held. Whereas my mama used to say, I put this in here for her, "Stevie, be careful what you wish for." I learned a great deal from Leon. He taught me about engineering and about record making in general, about songwriting. He taught me if you write a song for one person, there's a better chance that 10,000 people can relate to it than if you try to write a song for 10,000 people. And it's a great lesson. And when I say I learned from Leon, I tried to learn. You know, it's not like I maybe pulled it off. I'm still trying. He taught me, this is not sad for anyone, sad for me, because these moments are moments in time. Now you're, the anticipation ain't going to make you. He taught me, all right, he taught me about the Colonel Sanders method of selling chicken. You want to believe that the Colonel's personally frying a bet chicken just for you? Good lesson. I'm sorry. He taught me about the power and the glory of myth building. It's true. And no doubt I've done some myth building with regards to me and Leon. I confess this is kind of hard. I'm still in shock. Some kind of shock, because, you know, it's just a general haze and daze. I'll tell you this one little story. I kind of wrote down something so I could remember it. For the last few years, when I would see him quite often, he would mention to me his first electric guitar, a red Guild guitar. And I've thought now and then, well, I should get with Guild and get them to make him one of those guitars and then give it to him and make a big deal out of his red Guild guitar, but I never could quite figure out exactly what that guitar was. So without asking him and spoiling the surprise, I guess. So, you know, the last couple of days, and everybody's in a daze too, and somebody sends me a link and says that you probably saw this, and I had, but I watched it anew, and it was Elton John's induction of Leon into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And I say that just to say, on the little video, there was a photo of young Leon with his Guild guitar. And I know I'd seen that before, but it hit me. Oh, great. And truthfully, I backed up the video on my phone, and I got it just right so I could take a screenshot of that guitar. So, and I'm thinking, well, great, now I can get with Guild and make Leon that guitar. I mean, I'm a little late on that, but that's how weird this has been, time-wise. I'm not the master of space and time, and it's just disjointed. And I got so excited because I could finally get that guitar to Leon. Charlene and I live surrounded by Leon's stuff, his master tapes and his tape machines. Just, you know, it's our lives. We live in that Leon stuff. And it's hard to grasp that Leon isn't just gonna pull up in the bus or in the motorhome with Jan. Sorry. It's hard. One of the problems with this, the finality of this sort of thing, of this escape from Earth, one of the main problems for us left behind is that the time of questions and answers is over. I can't ask my dad stuff. I can't ask Leon this stuff. So many hours we spent together, masses of hours, and so many things that I wish I'd asked him. But when you're working, you know. And, you know, I just hoped for that time when I could just get to the bottom of a lot of these little things, trivial things, really. So I'm going to try to be happy here. I did ask him, excuse me, I'd say I'd collect myself, but I don't think it's going to happen. I did recently ask him a couple of questions, little things. I'm so glad I did. Small things, but his answers were great. I love them. I'd been transferring a lot of the Hank Wilson masters, the multi-track masters. It's amazing stuff. I've been a fan for 40 years. And I was just so impressed, so knocked out, listening to him sing those songs down one after another with Nashville's finest. There's probably dozens of great, great recordings from that period that were never released, and that I'm the first one to hear them in these 40-some years. I said, I often wondered, says I in an email. I've been transferring these tapes, and I'm curious. I'm going to read this so I really get his response right. I've always wondered if the name Hank Wilson was a merger of Hank Williams and Hank Thompson. Probably just my imagination, says I, running away with me, trying to be clever with Leon. Just my imagination running away with me. And I said, well, of course, we were both very young at the time. Leon answers, Steve, in addition to your rapidly running imagination, just don't try to pull anything with the boss. In addition to your rapidly running imagination, you have accuracy that matches mine in my respectful plagiaristic honoring of great composers that went before. Please don't tell anyone I said that. And he says, you are absolutely correct. Thompson and Williams, it is. Thanks to you, I got to tell Hank Thompson that when I spoke to him on the phone. That sounds like a more to Jim. Regards to you and your family, and some of you know this, regards to you and your family, Leroy Rozelle. He says, P.S. On a different note, that Leroy Rozelle alias above is based on a gospel tenor who was also a policeman in Tulsa. You know, that's good stuff. I don't know. Charlene and I got married in 1976, and like Leon sings in his added verse to Goodnight Irene, sometimes I live up in Tulsa, take a little trip down to Nashville to throw in L.A., and Leon did some bouncing around in those days between those three cities. Charlene and I did too. My first gig with Leon was his stage mixer or monitor mixer. I didn't really know him. It's a thankless job, monitor mixer. Hi, sound guy. We had a big band. I mean, it included Gary Busey on drums and some other drummers, I think, and then a bunch of singers, and it was a great band. He called me Mickey Monitor. Truthfully, just once, we're packing up, and I'm looking over the stage, and here comes Leon and Entourage walking to the bus. And he looks up at me, and he says, you'll get it right someday, Mickey Monitor. It probably was with his left hand. So after that tour, I talked him into hiring me as his personal engineer, and off we all went to L.A., or Burbank, really, or actually, this fancy little neighborhood called Toluca Lake. Leon's house was nestled in between Jonathan Winters and Bob Hope. It wasn't so funny at Leon's house, but it was a good place, and it was great having those, I don't know, bookends of comedy. That gig lasted about 3 months. We'd work late into the night, and one of those nights I returned to our little apartment and uttered the phrase that is one of the, we have a lot of famous phrases in Charlene and I's life with Leon, and this is one. Wake up, I've just been fired. And, you know, I say the story of why I was fired is, it's a fine little story, and I tell it It's for another time. I just wanted to add that the few times I've started to tell it when Leon was there, he goes, oh no, here we go. So back to Tulsa we came. Now, as it turns out, the lighting guy on that first tour I was on when I was monitor mixer was now my lifelong friend, Bob Burwell. And after the Leon tour ended, Burwell got a job with another lifelong friend, Jim Halsey. And Bob was, what I wrote down here in these thoughts was his right-hand guy. Jim and I were just talking, I'm not sure what any of us did. Now, Jim was in control, but I've had guys in Bob too going, I just don't know what, I mean, about Bob too. I don't know, I want to see what it is you guys do. I'm a little confused. But they hired me to build a studio first and then produce a couple records. And that was when we met, Charlene and I met, all of us, met and fell in love with beautiful and sweet Jan. She worked for Halsey too. Sorry. Jan Constantine. That was a good time, but Leon needed me. Well, that's nice. And talked me into coming back, and so off we went back to California, and things went really great this time, and our kids were born out there, Elvis and Angeline. And it was a good life. And I'd say, while I'm saying that, Leon loved the babies. Give me some sugar, he'd say. He loved our babies, bought them their first baby bed, which we still have. And he loved his own babies and grandbabies. The maximum amount. He loved you girls. Leon and I spent many hours, many, many hours, sometimes just the two of us and sometimes with some great musicians, recording. And a lot of video was shot with the newly formed Paradise video. It was the Ambrose Campbell Paradise Video World Headquarters something. And Leon was ahead of his time in so many things. And he was a little ahead of his time on that, way ahead of his time. And but it was an empire with a fabulous, fabulous bunch of people. And he was a forward thinker. And he drew forward thinkers to the... He would say, you know, if you get this thing right, meaning anything, people be knocking on your door wanting to do stuff. And that, you know, musicians, songwriters. And we had Roger Lynn building the drum machine, which is, I don't know how many know, but it was really Leon's idea to build a programmable drum machine. So thank or blame or both. But our lives were built around Roger's drum machine then for a long time. One day my buddy, and there was still some going back and forth, and my old buddy from the Halsey days and in the Leon tour, Bob Burwell, called. He said, I just flew in from Tulsa and I sat on the plane next to Leon. He says, this is a phone call. He says, you know how you'd think that sort of mushy, gushy, head over heels, over the moon, love stuff was kind of like a, would be a teenager kind of deal. He said, well, on the whole trip, Leon just gushed like a schoolboy because he had fallen in love with Jan. It's all he could talk about. And an unverified story, I personally believe it. He said, Burwell said, Jan told Leon later she didn't really want to marry a rock star. And Leon told her he'd quit and be a plumber. I don't know. I think he'd be good. It'd be entertaining. And for us, it then became Leon and Jan as one thing, one person. That's the way it is. That's the way it will be. And yes, I learned a great deal from Leon. We all did. Leon inspired loyalty and dedication. Even during it, I remark that he's the ship captain. He inspires the crew, you know, to go down with the captain. It's whatever it takes. There's some grumbling at times. And every once in a while, just for grins, we're going, well, I don't know if he's doing something wrong. And I'd say, well, he's always been good to me. I thought maybe he might walk in the office or something, but, you know, he was always good to me. So he inspired loyalty and dedication. Here's it, some folks. I worked with Leon off and on for 40 years. Leon's right-hand guy for getting things done, Skip. My old buddy, Nolan, got about the same amount of time in. All part of the team for decades, many others. The amazing Jackie Wessel. Jackie was there by Leon's side on stage, taking care of him on the road for decades. And I think, well, homage to Jackie Wessel, as he would say. The list of musicians that love and respect Leon still, whether it was from 50 years ago or just now, it's a long list and will continue. Not so long ago, I think, about a year ago, I think, Leon sent me an early Sunday morning, just, I don't know, maybe to paint the right picture or something. It was early Sunday morning text, just out of nowhere. He said some more stuff, but this is what I wanted to read you. The reason for connection is food, music. I mean, break off for a second. One of the other quotes that Liz drew. I said, well, you know, I'm going to be down there. I want us to pick you up at 11:30 and go eat. Well, we like to eat, he says. That's one of the quotes, one of the things we shared. The reason for connection is food, music, friendship, and tape machines. That was meant for us. And he says, the strong stuff is just the facts of life and death. You either laugh or cry. Or some of both, says I, some of both. This week, I hate hearing it, or reading it, or saying it. Leon has passed, but what I want to say is he is not gone. Leon will go on and on in music and stories and through his family and friends, through the fans, the Leon lifers. Leon will go on through music, through family, and friends, and workers like me. Leon is past, but he is not gone. The work continues. We all love this man that was somehow more than a man with all our hearts. Thank you.
also an engineer. I'm so glad that you spoke before I did, because you've said so much that I want to say and express, and Leon was I got hooked up with Leon. I was in Mexico City, and got a phone call from John Cowan's wife, Liz. Said that Newgrass was going to leave, and he wanted to put a rock band together. And John told him about me, and could I come and fly out here and audition? And so I was snuck out of Mexico City. I wasn't supposed to leave. I was like under it's some anyway. So I flew out here. I flew to went up to Hendersonville to the house there on the lake, Boudlow and Felice's old house, and played with him. John told me, you should just try and play like Freddie King or B.B. King. And so that's what I tried to do. And anyway, he ended up hiring me. And I flew back to California, loaded up my Nova, drove here, stopped in Tulsa, spent the night with Ronnie Dunn. He still lived there. And anyway, I lived at your house for 2-3 years, I'm not sure. Lived on the houseboat, lived in the house. That was part of the family in a way. He was really like a father to me. He taught me so. He taught me about music, obviously. He's responsible for the way I hear and play. And, you know, you hear Master of Space and Time, and it has a different meaning to me probably than a lot of people. To me, it's the space between the notes and the timing of where he puts his notes. That's the way I hear. That's what the Master of Space and Time is to me. He taught me about life as well. We rode in that motorhome, and either he was driving or I was driving, and, you know, late at night and just talking, and I said, I told him about Melissa, talk about him, and he said, you need to just marry her and start having babies. And so I did, and now we have grandbabies. He did love babies. He said, give me some sugar. He's kind of responsible for most everything in my life since I moved here. He's the reason I'm married to you, and that we have our wonderful daughters and granddaughter. And I don't know that I can really go on much more than Steve has covered so much of everything that should be said about him. And the main thing to me is just how much I love the man and what he meant to me, what you mean to me, what all of you mean to me. And I love you dearly. God bless you.
Well, thank you, God. Thank you, Creator. Thank you, Jesus. for offering us this service, this ceremony, for us to come and for a healing for us, for our loss and our grieving. And I've been a part of, let's say, the situation for a long time of the Leon Russell magic and the genius. With Jan, who was with our company for a long time, and then married my son Sherman, my late son Sherman, who was one of Leon's, and he, as they work on videos and experimental things with vision and video. But one thing that I'd like to comment on is the fact that Leon was a pure and true genius. And we all know a lot of very creative people. We associate and work with them. But not everybody goes beyond that and has the genius of an Einstein in their life, not just in the music and the songs and things like that. Leon was that type of genius. And part of what he did was offer a healing to the world out there with his music. There are millions of people that we'll never know, even know of, that were consoled, rejuvenated, restored, life put back into them from his music and his song. He had a magic about presenting that to where it reached every single person around the world. And those of us that are in this business see that every day with a lot of our musicians and performers and singers and songwriters, that we can do a concert and all of a sudden the concert is full. I don't care if you've got 2,000 people or 10,000 people, there are a lot of people in that concert that are suffering. And we may not know it, but it's debt or food or family or friends or illness or sickness or something, that all of a sudden in that 2 or 3 hour concert, they're transported to another place in life to where life is good again, maybe only for a few minutes, but they've been brought out of whatever their difficulty was by music, art, and entertainment. Leon had that magic in his words, in his music, and his performance to transport a lot of people out of their misery and into a place better for them. And even weeks or months or years later, those people that went to that concert or listened to that music can take back to it and bring themselves back. So while his life was one of music, performance, and songwriting, it really was one of service. And he did service for mankind. And a lot of things that have been in the past that are still serving today is his concert that for Bangladesh that he largely was responsible for putting together, and the millions of people that helped medically, with food, with shelter, and everything else. That will continue on. He may physically be gone, but spiritually and emotionally, his service lives on to heal all of us, to heal the world. It's going on now somewhere all around the world with that music that people are streaming, listening to, their records they're pulling out and playing again. That'll be good 40 years from now. That'll be good 100 years from now. We'll all be gone, but Leon will still be around healing people with his service. So my life is a life of gratitude. And I have gratitude that I knew our family has been involved with this artistic genius, Leon Russell. Thank you.
What a lovely turnout today for Leon. I'd like to start off saying that I courted my wife, Kathy, to Leon Russell music. Hold your hand up, Kathy, stand up. We're going to, it must have worked, it must have stuck, because we'll celebrate our 43rd wedding anniversary this coming Wednesday, so. Fellas, if you're having a hard time getting the gal, I suggest you get some vintage Leon Russell and play, get a hang down 8-track player in your car and a 63 Chevy Impala, and you can't go wrong, so. Anyway, I've been friends with Leon since 1983, but I've been a fan a lot longer than that. At the age of 11, there was a butcher in the grocery store that my family went to in downtown Bixby, Oklahoma, called Jesse's Market. And the owner's son-in-law was the butcher, and then he moonlighted in Tulsa as a soul singer. And the butcher singer's name was Bill Davis. And Bill would regale me with stories of Leon, what a fantastic session pianist he was. He was from Tulsa, and he was on a show called Shindig. And he also played on Beach Boys records and Dean Martin records and Frank Sinatra records, etc., etc. And I thought, man, that's amazing. I wonder why this guy doesn't put out records of his own. So speed ahead 5 years later, I'm sitting in a drafting class in Bixby High School, just outside of Tulsa. And one of my classmates hands me this blue album cover with this outrageous looking guy looking out from the front of it, grayish beard, long hair, top hat. He had a necklace on with a huge sharp tooth. I don't know what kind of animal that came off of. But he looked so cool looking off that cover. But besides that, it was just wonderful music. Roll Away the Stone, I remember hearing for the first time. It was just wonderful. And a friend of mine, friend of many of you here, writer John Woolley wrote this about that early vintage Leon in the 70s. I thought I'd share it with you today. According to John, the rock press led by Rolling Stone had been characterizing him as a kind of hip, laid-back ringmaster, keeping all these wild personalities together until it was time to unleash their energies on the stage. And that described Leon to a T. He was frenetic when he would get on stage. He would jump on the piano. He would grab a guitar. I mean, he just sped through that keyboard like it was just second nature to him, which it was. But Leon was huge after that. He was an Oklahoma guy, and on top of that, he was a Tulsa guy. And we were all on fire about what he was up to and what he was doing and the national popularity he was getting at the time. And like I said, I was first introduced to Leon and became friends since 1983. We were introduced by the late, sweet Emily Smith. And I just worked down the street, downtown Tulsa on 15th Street from Emily. And once I found out where she lived, I would go down once or twice a week on my lunch period and visit with her and tell her about all my findings, because I had such a passion for Leon in the early 70s, I started trying to find out all the sessions he played on, all his early work. So I would tell Emily about this, and I would collect things, and she would find things or tell me about things I needed to collect. Show me the late Denny Cordell's Cadillac with the Hawaiian license plates that was in her garage in Tulsa, and things like that. But she said, I'm going to introduce you to Leon, Steve. Leon needs good friends, and I think you would be a good friend for Leon. So hopefully I have all these years. But I thank Emily, the late Emily, for introducing us all those years ago. During my 40-plus years of research, I've discovered a lot of things about Leon. Some you may know, some you may not know. But I wanted to share a few things, those things with you today. He was born Claude Russell Bridges on April 2nd, 1942 in Lawton, Oklahoma. And his mother told me years ago, Hester was her name, that they didn't live in Lawton, but that was the closest hospital to Apache where they actually lived. And they lived, she took him home to Apache, and they lived there for 5 years before moving to Maysville and eventually moving to Tulsa because of his dad's job with the Texas Company, which became Texaco a few years later in 1953. But I found this very interesting. They didn't realize he had anything wrong with him physically until he was about 18 months old. And he was diagnosed with a spastic nerve disorder, is what his mother called it. But basically, it was a birth injury to his upper spine. And because of that, it partially paralyzed the right side of his body. And that's what gave Leon that distinctive dominant left hand that is so prevalent and recognizable in his keyboard work. When he was 4 years old, she told me this. Back in 87 when the family and I came here, without any prodding, he got on the piano at the age of four. And she said he had an interest in music, but not on the piano till that time. And he got up on the family piano and picked out the tune, the old church hymn, Trust and Obey, with his left hand, transposed it over to his right hand, and then played the whole song. And she said after that, he just took off. They got him formal lessons, and that was his new toy from that point on. He had another thing that happened to him at the age of four that would also have a great effect on him for the rest of his life. And what it was, they were at a family outing in Duncan, Oklahoma. And Leon said he discovered that his four-year-old cousin, the female cousin, had a different set of private parts than he did. So he decided to play doctor with her in the playhouse out back. And he said they were just getting started when his aunt showed up and, of course, put a stop to it and grabbed him and presented him to each adult family member at the get-together with scorching charges and descriptions of what he had done. And to quote Leon, said it affected him his entire life, created stage fright or agoraphobia, which was fear of the marketplace or fear of crowds. And he thought it had an immeasurable detrimental effect on his career in show business. Well, I believe that because I've seen him just on two or three occasions where he was struggling to not be nervous. But I also say that he probably managed it quite well because he appeared for decades in front of millions of people all around the world. So I think once he got out there and got comfortable, he was fine. But anyway, I thought that was interesting. In 1992, he sent me a lot of texts. We were looking at doing a book together. And there was a couple of things about the piano and about his session days out in L.A. that I thought I'd share with you. Now, these are Leon's words. He said, I used to go to jam sessions in California taverns that began at 6 a.m. on Sunday and went to about 4 or 5 in the afternoon. There was always one or no bass players that knew about the changes, maybe 5 or 6 drummers, and about 40 or 50 saxophone players. One morning, one of the sax players leaned over to me and said, "You don't play very much, but you never make any mistakes." I decided that was sort of a compliment. And he wrote this too. He said, there are as many different ways to play piano as there are fingerprints. One thing I noticed very early in the game is the apparent differences in the emotional value of different musical sounds or phrases. An example that comes to mind is the unbelievable piano style of Little Richard. It seemed to me that there was almost an almost visible line that separated the time before he played from the moment he started playing. You can imagine the impression that was made on my young mind as my lessons on Chopin were violently interrupted by the unleashed fury that was Little Richard. I came to think of this phenomenon as compelled involvement. In other words, when this type of music is played, it can't be relegated to the background. You have to become involved. And many of his early influences subscribe to that same compelled involvement. They included Jerry Lee Lewis, Chuck Berry, Bo Diddley, Junior Walker, Little Richard. And I was always surprised when I learned about this one, the flamboyant Escurita, who used to wear the hot pink Toreador pants around, had the big pompadour and sunglasses and stuff, and it was probably more outrageous than Little Richard. Now, Kathy and I were very pleased at times during our friendship with Leon to be included in many of his adventures. And a few that come to mind, one in particular, we were invited down to the Austin Opry House for a Wrangler talent show back in the 80s. And it was with Willie. Willie was hosting it, sponsoring it. It was Willie and Company. It was Dickie Betts. And who else played? Leon. I can't remember if Edgar was there or not. Anyway, we got to the venue, and Brad Davis, who was working for Leon at the time, said, Steve, the airline has lost Leon's piano. Is that Yamaha toy piano, I called it, 88-key toy piano. And what are we going to do? I think it's lost between the Dallas airport and Austin. And he said, I don't want to tell him. Do you want to tell him? Hell no, Brad, I don't want to tell him. I want Leon to continue to like me. So we did the only thing that made sense that day. We asked Willie to tell him. So we found Willie up in the war room. He was up there holding Trigger, his guitar. And we asked Willie to go tell him, and he did. And he let me hold Trigger for about 15 minutes while he was down there talking to Leon. And that was a big thrill to me as well, to hold the famous Trigger and see all those autographs in the top of it there. But that was fun. And we learned that night, actually that day, that when we're around Leon, the stars come out. And when I say stars, I mean the celebrities. We were sitting in the war room, and Harry Reasoner, the late Harry Reasoner, came in, was going to do an interview with Willie. And there was a movie being shot in Austin as well, the movie Nadine that starred Jeff Bridges and Rip Torn and Kim Basinger. And while we were sitting up in the war room with Leon, I forget who it was that came up, they said, Leon, Jeff Bridges is downstairs. He would like to come up and meet you. And he said, okay. So Jeff came up, and he was all clean-shaved and young back then. And he came up and visited with Leon, and it didn't occur to me at the time. Of course, they both had the same last name. But anyway, after the fact, we had taken a picture of the two of them together with my wife, Kathy, in the middle. And so we call that photo at home, Kathy and the Bridges Boys. But we cherished that time and that photo. And one little addendum to that day in the Austin Opry House. Once the competition started and the band started, and during Leon and Willie's band set, they had a little private balcony above the stage. And Jeff Bridges was up there with a few of his, I think one of his brothers was there, Kathy, the non-acting brother, yeah, and some other folks. And I don't know why, but the actor Rip Torn took a shining to me. And if you know anything about Rip Torn, he's a hoot. And he's an interesting guy. But we were up in that balcony, and there may have been some alcohol involved. I don't remember. But when Rip gets ripped, crazy things happen. So we were up there, and I'm not going to say I was innocent, but we got booted out of the balcony for maybe being a little too rambunctious. Well, they just escorted us downstairs, and somebody came up to the I want to call him a bouncer, usher, whatever, that was with us, and they said, "What are you doing?" That's Leon. He was pointing at me. He said, "That's Leon Russell's attorney. You can't kick him out. Take him back upstairs." So we went back upstairs, and as soon as we entered the balcony area, Jeff Bridges had this kind of odd look on his face. And immediately Rip Torn flipped him the bird. So we sat down and finished the show, and we tried to mind our P's and Q's. But, man, that guy was a hoot, I'll tell you. And Leon's piano never did show up. He used the house piano. In 1986, Kathy and I decided, because he hadn't been there in a while, that we would start promoting Leon in an annual birthday bash in April in Tulsa. So we picked the Brady Theater as the venue. He and Jan had started a new family in Nashville, and he just hadn't traveled to Tulsa as much, wasn't booked in Tulsa as much, and it's kind of almost like starting over. So we booked him in there. It was our first promotion. Now, we've done many since then in Tulsa, but it was our first one. It was a learning experience for us, and we probably bought too much advertising. Kathy decided she was going to cook his after-show meal for him. So I asked Leon, I said, "What do you want Kathy to make?" So he said, "Bearded mussels, steamed bearded mussels." She'd never cooked them before. But she got some recipes, family recipes, or for some friends or something. And she cooked them. She spent all day working on those and took them up there and kept them warm. And after the show, she served them to him on the bus. And while she was serving them to him, I was asking Leon, did you really play on the Monkees album? He says, "Well, yeah, you know, I played on a couple of sessions, but they were a little too soulful for those guys, so we never used them." Well, while I'm talking to him, Kathy's trying to serve him. And I know I bumped her at least once, if not more. She spilled a little mussel juice in his lap. But he was a real good sport about it. But we decided after that first concert, we'd just get Wilson's Barbecue for his after concert show, which is probably what he wanted anyway, but because he loved Wilson's Barbecue. And we actually broke even on that first concert, which I'm sure Mr. Halsey can tell you is not an easy thing to do on your very first concert promotion. But we've done many more since then. Some were good, some were not so good. We had a nice one back for his 70th in 2012. We were hoping to do one next year for his 75th at the casino there in Tulsa, kind of beat us to it. Which we were glad, because we can't compete with casino money, you know. I'm not sure Sir Elton could either. Maybe he could, but they pay a lot of money, and we knew it would be a better venue and a better payday for him. But hopefully next year you can still have some tribute shows and celebration shows to celebrate Leon's 75th birthday. But we had a lot of fun doing those. Last story. In the early part of 2015, we were invited to Austin to see the film premiere at South by Southwest of the old documentary, Les Blank documentary, A Poem is a Naked Person. And let me give you a little backstory on that. Diane Sullivan, who bought Leon's old Sky Hill Drive house where he had his recording studio back in the 60s, we took a family vacation out there in the early 80s, and while we were out there, Diane and I would go to the old record shops when they were still plentiful and look for a lot of the records that we thought Leon had played on. Anyway, she gave me a videotape that she had taken over 3/4 inch of a poem as a naked person. And it had a lot of glitches and stuff in it. It wasn't the best quality, but you kind of get the gist of the documentary. And I knew it had never been released. I didn't know why, but years later I found out there was a lot of infighting about it. Leon had taken, had forgiven a loan or two to Shelter in lieu of 100% rights in it. He and Les had not gotten along there at the end after two long years. It was also about the time, you know, it wasn't too long after that, that Shelter, Denny and Leon had split up and Shelter was broken up. So I knew there was some issues there. Les could show the film once a year if he was present at a retrospective of his work. And that was it. So, probably starting in about 2010, I started in on Leon again. Leon, would you give me permission to get Les to show that thing before a concert or the night before a concert or something for the fans and to draw interest for your concert? Nah, I don't really want to do that. You know, I just, you know, I'll tell you about it sometime. So anyway, I thought at the end of 2014, the Circle Theater wanted to honor Leon with a star on a sidewalk, which I believe they finally did there in Tulsa. And they wanted to show that film. So I made one last plea to Leon. Would you allow that to be shown? And I got this email back. Bless his heart. He said, Steve, we've talked about this. That film will never be shown in public, period. Yours truly, Rossell. So I dropped it. Well, imagine my shock and surprise when in early 2015 I get an email from Herod Blank. Herod, are you here? Stand up, Herod. Let the people see you. Thank you. Yeah. Herod is Les's son. And Les died, was it this past year? 2013. Okay, my bad. Herod had reached out to Leon over the last couple of years and asked him, I think maybe it was your dad's dying wish or something, that some way, somehow, Leon could find it in his heart to get Poem as a Naked Person released. Well, he was going to digitize it. He was going to clean it up. He was going to recut it. And was your initial response no, or did you get a maybe when you... Okay. I'm not sure what the time sequence was there, but Leon told us when we finally got to this, we had a dinner before the premiere, and he knew what was on my mind because the last word from him was, no, this film will not be shown in public. So when we get to a dinner right before the showing of this film in Austin, there at the dinner table, he told me, he said, Steve, there's a couple of reasons I changed my mind. You're probably wondering why. I said, yes, yeah, I kind of am. Well, first of all, it was because of Herod. He found you a refreshing change of pace. He really liked you. And the fact that you were willing to come to him and offer these changes and things, he felt like was a step in the right direction. And he was very happy to work with you on that. So that was half of the reason he said yes. The second reason he said yes was because of a Walt Disney movie. And I said, what is that? What happened? He said, I saw Saving Mr. Banks. He said, after watching it, I realized sometimes we say no just to be saying no. And he realized he was being selfish about it. And he knew his fans would enjoy it. So he went forward with Herod. And they had many, many showings around the country. It's out on DVD now. And there are some maybe considered unflattering parts for Leon that would be hard for me to sit through if I'd been in his shoes. But I guess he was a real trooper about it, and he would stay and do Q&As afterwards and stuff. And it was a real, I think, boost to him to see how many people showed up for that film and how much they loved it, and of course how much they loved Leon too. So anyway, it was great, and I was glad it finally got to see daylight. So good job, Herod. I think I'd be remiss if I didn't mention a few people while I'm up here today. First of all, Leon's band. You guys stand up. Jack Wessel, bass player. Raise your hand, Jack. Jack's been around for as long as I can remember with Leon, watching his back and keeping the bass line going there, and done a fantastic job. Brandon Holder, Bo Sharon. Brandon plays drums. Bo plays everything else but bass and drums. And they are the most dangerous band alive, as far as I'm concerned. And you guys do a wonderful job. Now, they will be performing with John Fulbright at the Tulsa Memorial on Sunday at the Mabee Center. So for you that are going to be there, it'll be fantastic. If you can't, I know the Mabee Center is going to stream it from various camera angles. So be sure and tune in. But thank you, fellas. And thanks for supporting Leon for all these years. Elton John has some people here today. Johnny Barbas, would you please stand up? Is John Howard here? John? Wonderful folks that represent Elton, and that was the most, I'll say it again, I said it at the time, it's the most unselfish act I've ever seen, what Elton did for Leon. So give them a big hand. And then Leon and I have a mutual friend here. She's a writer that doesn't live too far away. Elena Nash, would you stand up, please? I got a call one Sunday afternoon. Leon was at a restaurant, and he said, "Hey, Steve, you know those photos I wanted for Life Journey booklet that we didn't do?" "Yeah, I remember. I need you to send those to an author I'm meeting with right now." She's sitting here next to me. Her name's Elena Nash. I said, "I know. I remember Elena Nash. I know of her." I said, "Leon," she was one of the first writers who I saw write a big article on you back in the early 70s. I said, "I remember that article like it was yesterday." So, yeah, I know who Elena Nash is. And there was this pause on the phone. He says, "Figures." So we put Elena on, and we visited, and we've corresponded and talked ever since. But she had talked with Leon about doing a biography. But like a lot of things in real life, there just wasn't time or the sufficient time to make it happen. But always be grateful for spending time with him and at least trying to nudge him in that direction. So. In closing, I want to tell Jan and the girls just how much Kathy and I loved and admired Leon and him do anything for him. Of course, that goes both ways. He included us in things we probably had no business being included in throughout our lives. But it reminds me of, I want to thank Honey, too, personally for, I said this earlier, but thanks for giving up your room when I would come to town to stay with you guys. So, and I hope I didn't mess up any of your things in there. So. And I also, this reminds me to also like to say that Leon was one of the few dads I know that dropped his kids' friends off back home in a tour bus. I'd never seen anything like that before in my life. We'd be on the bus going to a show, maybe down at the river or something, and we'd have to drop some kids off back home. So that was interesting. And I told Leon this in Austin, and I'll say it again. And when I told him that, he says, "I like being the only one of something." And what I told him was, I said, "God broke the mold when he made you, Leon." And he liked that. And we may never see his kind again, but he will be missed. Thank you.
My name's Bill Maxwell. I'm a drummer, a musician from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. And the first time we heard Leon play, we thought, he must be from Oklahoma City. He couldn't be that good and live in Tulsa. But there's a big competition between those two cities, but I think Tulsa wins. And I've known Leon since the late 60s. I think I met him through Delaney Bramlett or Jesse Ed Davis. And we would casually run into each other over the years. And I just have to say I love Leon. I love him. I'm not going to say past tense. I love him. And Leon was a huge, or is a huge personality. Probably the biggest I've ever met. He could be in a room being quiet, but he took up so much space. And I've been around some big personalities, Elvis Presley or Muhammad Ali. Leon's was bigger. And when I got the call on Sunday that Leon had left, all of a sudden a big piece of my heart left. I had a hole. He was so big, I was troubled. I was hurt. And I went to the only place that I knew where I could get help, and that's the Bible. And I just started reading in John, and where Jesus said, don't let your hearts be troubled. My heart was troubled. He said, don't let it be troubled. I go to make a place for you with my Father. And where I go, I make a place for you. There's many mansions there. I thought, well, good. Leon's going to have a house. He said, okay. And so I wasn't troubled about that. He says, trust me, I wouldn't tell you these things if they weren't true. I said, okay, I trust you. It's true. Leon is alive. He's in heaven. And then I started thinking more about it. I said, let me think. Well, if he's left, what happens when you leave? And I was reading in 2 Corinthians, and it said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So I knew Leon is. I started thinking, well, what is he? He's young. He's alive. He's full of life. He's full of power. He's creative. He's doing things. He's happy. And so I immediately had to correct myself. I will no more say Leon Russell was. No, Leon Russell is. Can you say that? Leon is. Leon is. Leon is alive. I tell you. And he's alive in this family. He's alive in the people that love him and care about him in the music. But he is spiritually alive. And for those that doubt that Leon had a faith, he believed. And my relationship with him kind of goes into that. It's hard for me, but I became a record producer producing Christian music in the early 1970s, producing Andre Crouch. And I ran into Leon maybe in 1974, and he was one of the biggest stars in the world then, and very busy, didn't do sessions anymore. And I said, boy, I wish he still played sessions, because I'd love to have you play on, it was the second album I produced for Andre Crouch, This Is Another Day. And he said, well, Billy, I'll do that for you. And he was always that way. And he came in and played and just played fantastic. And I was so thankful that he did that. And over the years, I worked with him on different occasions. He would play something for me or I'd see him. And I just love seeing him and love seeing Jan. And in 2010, my old friend T-Bone Burnett called me and said, Elton John and Leon Russell are doing an album called The Union. And it'd be great if you could be involved and help us in some way. And we're over at the Village Recording Studios. Why don't you drop by? So I came by the studio, and it was a big thing. Elton was there, and beautiful Johnny Barbas was there, and Cameron Crowe with the film crew, and there was a big scene. And I looked over, and Leon was in a chair, and he looked like he was almost dead. I didn't know he just had brain surgery. And I went over to him and said hello, and we both started crying. And Leon said, I'm so glad you're here to help me on this. And I was excited. They wanted me to arrange and conduct and kind of produce the background vocals for this album. So in a few days later, I brought four or five girls into the session. Leon had worked on a song called There's Always Tomorrow. I think what's the name of it, Johnny? Yeah. And Leon was there by himself. Elton wasn't there, T-Bone wasn't there, Cameron wasn't there, no crew. And so we played the song, and I had the girls start kind of singing what we thought we'd do, and I looked over, and Leon's crying like a baby. And I said, well, I think we're going to get it right. And I said, Leon, you got to do me one thing. If you like what we do, I need you to come out and play piano and sing something for the girls. So we finished the song. He loved it. And I took him to the piano, and I found out he had not been playing piano at all. He was playing a synthesizer because his hands were weak, and he didn't find a piano with a touch he liked. He just wouldn't hardly touch an acoustic piano. But he sat down at Elton's Yamaha piano and played this Masquerade in the New Orleans style and sang it. And he was like, he started coming to life. He had gone from being withdrawn. He was getting power within him. And when he finished, I told the girls, I said, Leon's been very sick. He almost died. He had brain surgery. And Alfie Silas, the great soprano, said, well, we need to pray for Leon. So we did. And I'll tell you, as we prayed for him, it was like he got stronger. And every session, everything we did, and I just want to thank God for Elton John, what he did to encourage and bring that, and Johnny Barbaros and T-Bone. It was a labor of love. I'm just so thankful and proud to have been a part of it. So I fast forward a couple of years later. Leon and Elton were not touring together anymore, and the girls that I'd hired were now working with Elton John at Caesar's Palace. And so I went to Las Vegas to see the performance. I found out Leon was performing at the Orleans Hotel. So after Elton's show, I said to the girls, let's go surprise Leon. So I put him in my car, drove over to the Orleans, and I knew Leon would never stay in a hotel. He always stayed on his bus. So I went around to the back and saw his bus, called him on his cell phone, and he said, hey, Billy, where are you? I said, I'm outside your bus. He said, okay, come on in. He opened the door, and I surprised him with these great four singers, and we walked in the bus. Leon was eating pie. And sat down, and Leon said, can we sing? And even though I produced a lot of Christian music, I don't know those gospel songs. I didn't come up in a black church. Leon knew more songs. I don't know where he heard all these songs, but he knew them. And he started singing with the girls, and this went on for a half hour. And these are strong singers. Tata Vega, Sly Stone's sister, Rose. I mean, powerhouses. And Leon was drowning them out. He was so full of it. He was just going at it. And again, we left, ended again with us praying with Leon. And he was, again, there's Leon crying. We left. I get a text a few minutes later. Billy, thank you for coming by. You just made my day. And I just loved him so much. And so on January 8th of 2015, Andre Crouch died, and Leon loved Andre. And so I was helping with the memorial service and playing in the band, putting the band together. And I called Leon, and he said, well, I can't be there, but would you send me something from the service? I'm going to read you what Leon wrote to me, if I can find it here. We had a lot of great singers at that performance, Stevie Wonder, Kim Burrell, B.B. and C.C. Winans, the Winans family. It was, you know, incredibly good, Shirley Caesar. So I don't know what I sent Leon, but I sent him something. And he wrote this back, and I think I kept it for today without knowing. And this is what he said. And I felt sometimes like a blind Thomas stumbling through this world alone, but Andre reached out to me. He encouraged me. I was an outsider looking at the wonders inside, longing to be a part of this thing that made me start crying a block away from the church door. What was this thing? But Andre reached out to me. He told me I was already a part of this wonderful thing, whether I knew it or not. I never quite felt I could do enough for him. He gave his gift to everyone. He offered strength in a quiet voice. He reached out to me. He reached out to me. Billy, thank you for letting me see part of this wonderful memorial service. You're the greatest. I love you, Leon. Well, I feel that Leon reached out to me, and he reached out to so many of us. And I'm thankful for Leon, and I have to make a few regards from Leon's old-time friend and drummer, Jim Keltner. He's my friend. He's from Tulsa. Wanted me to say that how much he loves the family, and he loves Jan, and he wished he could be here, and that he feels he owes his whole musical career to Leon, as do so many of us. And from my wife, Yvonne, and my daughter, Tanya, who sang with Leon on the Union album, and Elton, and went on tour. And then one more thing is, I have a note from the girls, the background singers, that toured with Elton, Leon, and Elton. Leon loved them so much. And this is what they wanted to say. After we toured with Leon, there was a void. But we knew we just had to pull up Leon's music and listen to him, and it filled that void. Thank God for this multidimensional, poetic person he was that was expressed through his lyrics. We knew that there was a place in his heart for the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. He was not ashamed. His light always shined brightly through him. We love Leon, and we'll never forget his quiet spirit. We know there's many up-and-coming artists that should, we'd only hope that they would take time and be gracious enough to learn about him. We are so honored that we were chosen to be a part and to participate in the legacy of such a cool dude. He had authentic persona and swagger, and we will so cherish and praise God for what time we had to spend with Leon Russell. No wonder there'll be another one like him. Tata Vega, Rose Stone, Lisa Stone, and Gene Witherspoon. Thank you, guys.
Well, first of all, it's a real honor to be asked to speak. Thank you. I think they asked me because I'm a preacher's kid, and they thought I could get through this easier than the rest of them, but honestly, this is one of the hardest things I've ever had to do. I met Leon the first time on stage. I'd never met him before. I got a phone call from my friend Brian Lee, wanted me to come play a show because Grant had suffered a stroke. I was so excited because growing up in Tulsa, I'd known Leon, his music, everything about him, stories. If you live in Tulsa, if you know anybody from Tulsa, everybody in Tulsa knows Leon and is related to him somehow. There's no getting around it. Somebody's brother was his brother or sister. So I've grown up feeling that family connection already, being a Tulsa guy. And so it was really exciting for me to get on stage and look across and see that man that I'd grown up listening to my whole life and know that I was a part of something just for one night. I had no idea that he would ask me actually to come on that journey with him and be a part of his family, basically, musical family, as we all are. I think we all feel that way. Chris, I see you here. Anybody who's traveled with Leon knows that we traveled as a family. We lived as a family. Other bands, other people I would talk to, they couldn't believe that we actually traveled the way we did. To us, it was normal. To us, it was a closeness. You know, we were there, good times and bad times. Boy, we had some bad times. It's funny, whenever the band, me and Bo, were coming up here, we were going to stay on the bus. On our way, we get a phone call that says, the bus is broken down. I looked at Bo and I said, Leon's still alive. We're still working for him, obviously, because the bus is broken down. And again, like we've, you know, always is. Leon was a person that I was with him for 8 years, and I know that's a speck of time compared to a lot of people that are here. But for some reason, we became close. I don't know why. I asked Jackie one time, I said, what is it about me that he wants me to keep him around? Am I just a good drummer? Or what? Jackie said, Leon hates drummers, and he likes you for some reason, so you'll probably be around for a while. About 4 months after I've been with Leon, and I'm going to tell this story for a reason. After about 4 months I've been with Leon, I came to him and sat across on the couch from him. So he's laying back in his recliner watching Lifetime Channel or some gushy woman drama. Yeah, yeah. And I said, we pause that for a second. I want to ask you something. I said, you know, I've been with you for 4 months, and you've never once said a word. If you like my drumming, if you like what I'm doing, you know, anything. You haven't said a word to me. And it's really confusing me. I don't know if I'm okay in your eyes. He said, well, PK, I'll tell you what. If you ever do something I don't like, I'll tell you about it. And I say that to say that he's not a guy that would just rattle on. He wouldn't just talk for no reason. He spoke and had a reason for everything he said. I don't ever remember a time when he just was rattling off nothing to me. It was always something. He meant it when he said it. and he wanted to say it. It was never just stupid conversation, whether it was teaching without knowing or telling me jokes that I wouldn't get for days afterwards. Finally realized that he was messing with me, which that happened a lot. I'm a little naive in that way. But he really touched all of us. And, you know, at times we all hate each other and we all love each other. But in the end, that's what family is. That's how families survive, is by being honest like that and hating and loving. And I think I speak for everybody in the room, but especially the guys I know that played with him. We love him. And he will definitely be missed. And thank God we don't have to do that Muppet show he was wanting to do, because he had some... You know what I'm talking about. He had Muppets for all of us. I guess that's what I wanted to say, and my heart goes out to you, because you guys, obviously, we've become close over the years, all of you. Peyton, I feel like I'm your second father or whatever. Just stay straight, buddy. I guess that's all I had to say. We're going to miss him.
Before I read this letter that Elton had sent along, I wanted to say that I would have never been in the record business if it wasn't for Leon when I started at Shelter in 1972. That he opened the door for me, and he gave me, he was the greatest. And I want to read this letter that Elton sent to the family and to Leon. I can't imagine a world without Leon's music. He was the turbo engine that helped start my career. His kindness and generosity enabled me to have confidence and faith in what I was trying to achieve as an artist. That was so important to me. A gesture of gratification from the master himself meant everything at that time. He was everything I wanted to be as a pianist, vocalist, and writer. His music has helped me and millions of others in the best and the worst of times. He was unique. He was a unique man, a God-given talent. He didn't waste it. He took it and flew. He became the master of space and time. That our paths crossed again in the last few years meant so much to me. To record, write, and to watch him work gave me a memory that will be in my heart forever. I loved him and will miss him. Luckily, we all have the songs and the music that will never die, but will remain for generations to marvel and wonder. Godspeed, my friend, into the hands of angels, and to the loved ones my family sends their love and condolences. Amen. Elton.
There is so much love in this room. I feel like it's going to float away. Unfortunately, there are a lot of people who couldn't be here today because of touring commitments or prayer engagements. So we've had so many messages, and we don't have time to read every single one, but I'd like to share with you what we have. From Whoopi Goldberg. I felt maybe because my family loved Leon's music that he always felt a bit like family. Maybe it was because he didn't look like anyone else, seemed to be sure of who he was and comfortable being him. When I finally met Leon, all I could say was, "Hey, Leon Russell." And he said, "Hey, Whoopi." And what can I tell you? In that short exchange, I understood that he was family and how lucky I was to have gotten to meet and spend moments and time with he and Jan. His picture sits on my piano with the rest of the family. A note from Bruce Hornsby. Along with Elton John and later Keith Garrett, was the inspiration that made me interested in and then continued, or then consumed with playing piano and writing songs. He was completely unique, a deep, soulful presence who had a groove and a feel on the piano that was unmatched. He always wanted to write standards, songs that would become part of the Great American Songbook, and he did just that. Writing such songs as A Song for You and This Masquerade that will be sung forever. But my favorite Leon was the wide-open, incredibly joyous, gospel-charged rockers that made his concerts so transformative and amazing. I thought I had a pretty solid Leon imitation on the piano until I started working and hanging with him. Watching what he did up close was eye-opening, way deeper and more complex than what I had been doing. He schooled me in old gospel piano traditions, like the Church of God in Christ style, from which he had drawn so much. To hang out with Leon was to always emerge with a classic vignette, a memorable turn of phrase, a funny or amazing old story. He was a walking trove of information, inspiration, and humorous antidotes. This may be the part of him I miss the most, but the music, of course, will live on. And I will always reference Shelter People, Leon and the Newgrass Revival, Asylum Choir Records for inspiration and pure enjoyment. Like a great many lifelong fans and friends, I'll miss him forever, Bruce Hornsby. This note is from John Cowan. It starts with, in bold, the word pilgrim, in quotes, pilgrim. Webster's definition, a person who journeys, especially a long distance, to some sacred place as an act of religious or spiritual devotion. In 1979, as a member of the Newgrass Revival and Leon's band, we recorded Merle Travis's iconic song, I Am a Pilgrim, for Leon's album, Hank Williams Back, Volume 2. The chorus of this song states, I am a pilgrim and a stranger traveling through this worrisome land. I've got a home in that yonder city, and it's not made by man. Leon Russell was a pilgrim in every sense of the word. At age 17, he literally did get on a Greyhound bus in Oklahoma and headed to Los Angeles. His own pilgrimage to the promised land. So many of Leon's song lyrics over the years have been imbued with the proposition and observance of our humanness in a spiritual world. It would be a disservice to a man I loved so much to presume to state what I think his spiritual beliefs were. There are, however, many clues in his own lyrics. Stranger in a Strange Land in verse 3, and the baby looks around him and shares his bed of hay with the burrow in the palace of the king. One More Love Song says, I'm down on my knees, put my problems in God's hand, give me strength to carry on and the heart to understand. Prince of Peace tells us never treat a brother like a passing stranger, always try to keep the love light burning. In the bridge of A Song for You, Leon humbly sings, you taught me precious secrets, the truth withholding nothing. You came out in front and I was hiding. But now I'm so much better, and if my words don't come together, listen to the melody, because my love is in there hiding. Finally, in Jesus Will Take Me Home, Leon roars, in the darkest of hour, in the blackest night, something's wrong and nothing's right. And the hurt's so strong, and the night's so long. I hear the silence everywhere, but Jesus will take me home. Jesus will take me home. Leon's long journey on this earth is done. The pilgrim is finally home. I can tell you on a personal level that as a boss, a friend, and a mentor, Leon was kind, respectful, encouraging, humorous, and of course, very much human. There will be much said and written about the effect Leon has had musically, culturally, socially, and spiritually. And all of it will be undeniably real. Leon's gigantic lion heart will be what always resonates in my own after all these years of listening, learning, and sharing with him. I would like to publicly thank Jan for holding that beautiful pilgrim's heart of Leon's in devotion, unflinchingly and tenderly, for giving it wings to fly and a safe place to land. Much love, John Edward Cowan. Yeah. The next note is from Tommy LaPuma. Leon was a very important part of my life. From first we met in 1962 to his tragic passing this last week. I had just come out of Hollywood from Cleveland, Ohio, as a fledgling promotion man for Liberty Records. And, as it turns out, I was taken to see an artist, Jackie DeShannon, who was appearing at a local club in Hollywood. I couldn't help but be attracted to the piano player in the band that was backing her up. He was dressed in a blue seersucker suit with a burgundy tie, and his hair was neatly coiffed with a pompadour. He also had a very sullen and serious look on his face. He had a unique style of playing that was all his own, and I made sure I got his name before we left the club. Turns out that he was doing quite a bit of work for the head of A&R at Liberty, Snuff Garrett, and I got a chance to meet him. It turns out that that serious and sullen look was just that, a look. He was a very warm and personable guy, at least to me. It wasn't until a few weeks later that I had my first chance to use his talents as a musician and arranger when I started to make demos for Liberty's publishing company, and not too long afterwards when I started to produce records, when I started making song demos. I didn't know my ass from a mixing board, but Leon, in his subtle, astute way, knew I needed help and did just that. He taught me the ropes, and I asked him to write the arrangements for my first production, which was with the OJs. No, it wasn't Love Train or Backstabbers. It was their first album, and we did score a regional hit off the chart Leon wrote. Several years later, my partner and I started a small record company called Blue Thumb. And as it turns out, Leon had just partnered with Denny Cordell and started a label called Shelter. And that made Leon's first solo record, with all of those songs he had written, like Song for You, Hummingbird, and Delta Lady, and we distributed it on Shelter Blue Thumb label. We sold our company to a major, and I went to Warner Records, and he and Denny went on to Mad Dogs and Englishmen and a few more great records, one of which was called Carney. That had the great song, This Masquerade, on it. I recorded it with an artist I had just signed called George Benson. It turned out to be a smash, and it kick-started my career. We lost touch for a while, but in 2001, I asked him to appear with many artists that I had worked with to celebrate my 75th birthday at the Montreux Jazz Festival, which we did. And at that reunion, he asked me to produce what turned out to be the last record that Leon released on a major label called Life Journey. I was very proud of that record, not only for its content, but because we became very close buddies making it and kept in close touch right up until the time he became too ill to talk. For the most part, Leon was a pretty private person with a big distrust of anything that smelled corporate or flashy. He was basically a family man who loved his partner in life, Jan, and adored his beautiful girls. He was a closet intellectual. He read a lot, but never boasted or bragged about his knowledge. The world just won't be the same without him. But we have comfort in the knowledge that he left his legacy in many great songs that we just need to listen to and feel. His presence. I'll miss him. Tommy LaPuma. This next letter is from Jackie DeShannon. What can one say about a masterpiece except it's a masterpiece? Leon was one of a kind, a musical masterpiece painting. The very first time I heard him play, I knew he was a genius. There will never be another like him. He will be missed. My thoughts and prayers are with his family at this difficult time. Love you, Leon. Jackie DeShannon. This note is from Michael Johnstone. I met Leon when he was building his home studio down in Toluca Lake, and he contacted me because he heard I could wire up recording studios, and he needed a couple extra hands. As soon as he found out I was also a steel player, he offered to teach me piano, if I'd teach him the pedal steel. I wanted to play guitar and steel in his band so bad I could taste it. But I guess I was more valuable to him in those days as an engineer and a studio tech. It was Leon who introduced me to George Harrison one fine day. And the legendary Wrecking Crew all came through that studio too, Carol Kaye and all the rest. Leon Wrightley figured video is the future of the music business years before MTV. So we built a soundstage to film and record live music. I was reliving Shindig all over again. Leon saw that I could invent things and do things and let me do them. He built a $1 million video editing suite when they were few and far between and gave me the keys to it. Somewhere in there, he and I bonded like brothers. He told me one night in that Tulsa draw, Michael, did I ever tell you that I like your, and that's spelled Y-E-R, your program? Because I really like your program. That's hillbilly for I love you, man. We made Willie Nelson records and videos and J.J. Cale records and videos and a whole bunch of other projects, like the Newgrass Revival Live concert tour and album, and then the weekly USA Network TV show, New Wave Theater. In 1979, he and I went to Nigeria in search of the roots of rock and roll. I don't know if we found them, but we sure had a hell of an adventure in the process. I could write a book about that trip alone. After he moved to Nashville, I saw less of him, but we did hang out whenever we'd cross paths in Florida, Colorado, Las Vegas, Nashville, LA, or wherever, and we shared lots of late-night phone calls. One night in Malibu in 2005, he finally offered me a spot on the stage for my guitar, pedal steel, and mandolin, and a bunk on his bus, but he caught me in the midst of raising a daughter. So through bitter tears, I had to turn his offer down. A twist of fate I shall regret till I join him in the hereafter. I continued to visit him whenever he was in LA and just saw him last May at the Blues and Cajun Festival in California when I brought my family down to spend the afternoon on the bus. That was the last time I saw Leon. He played us his new record and was enthusiastic that I had taken up the Chapman stick and couldn't wait to hear what I was doing on it. He always went out of his way to validate me and my musicianship, and that meant so much to me coming from one of the greatest musical voices of his generation. Now, I'm going to have to play his music all by myself. Once or twice in a lifetime, you do get to meet and be in the same room with what I call magic people. In rare cases, you actually become friends with them. I shall miss and cherish this magic person with his gentle soul and fierce talent as long as I live. They say you can tell a lot about a person by the space they leave behind. Leon, my friend, you left a beautiful space. The last note that I'm going to read is from Greg Harris, and he is the president and CEO of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. On behalf of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and music fans around the world, our heartfelt condolences to the Russell family and those in attendance today. Leon's impact and influence was massive. Session man, band leader, songwriter, arranger, front man, side man, producer, his work touched millions. Loved and admired by his fellow artists, Leon was the flashpoint between a sea of incredibly powerful music. Labels didn't matter, rock, blues, gospel, country. Through it all, he was simply a soul-filled artist. Today, we mourn his passing and we celebrate his music. And we are honored that his legacy will live forever at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Greg Harris.
My role as a preacher has been pretty clear. With the number of preachers who were going to preach today, I didn't need to do much of that. My job was to come forward and to tell you when we were starting and to pray, and then to come in at the end and let you know when we were done and pray. And as a preacher, there were plenty of us up here. But as a pastor, I want to just help make sure you know the gift you've been given, so that when I close the service out and you go, "What now?" I think it's pretty obvious. It's not your job to fill that coat and that hat. God put somebody else on earth to do that. When God made Leon Russell, God broke the mold because God only wanted one Leon Russell. But when God made you, God broke the mold as well. Because those who are so neon at living out their life are to enable us to be able to live out our lives. And when you discover your music, your song, what you have that the world needs, the stage gets bigger. Because those people who understand who they're supposed to be make room for lots of people on stage. I don't even understand how it's possible to have that many people on stage and still have music. But that takes one. I mean, I'm just a listener. But to have that many people on stage takes somebody who is very comfortable in their hat, their coat, and their skin, no matter how those hats and coats changed over the years. But that's how you know when you've discovered how you're going to be the one God needs for you to be. To be comfortable with the silence between the notes. We aren't very comfortable with silence, and so we fill our world with noise and we make little music. To be comfortable with the silence is to understand how the song goes. To make music from nothing is where the beauty is. To know when one song ends so that another can begin. That's how you write a lot of songs. You don't just never let the song end. You let it go and then you let other people sing it. To be able to sing the song for the one, a song for you, enables you to sing a song for many. But that's our job. You don't have to sing a song for a million, but there's somebody who needs your song or your story, or your words, or your prayer in a way that only you can give. And that's the song you have to do for somebody. That's the life you have to live for somebody. Not over many years, but just one song, one day, one moment at a time. And I tell you, if ever we needed it, It's time we all picked up that vision and look over the rainbow and be able to tell others what we see, because all we hear publicly today is a vision of nightmare. All we hear is the shadow of death, and we can't see beyond that shadow. So some people have to shine that light for us. Some people have to look beyond that rainbow and see what the other side looks like and tell us it's going to be okay. In fact, more than that, it's going to be wonderful. And that's what this singer did. And to start with Psalm 23 and the person who wrote it, I want to end with it. Because I want to point you out something, that there weren't metrical changes back then that you could just change a key and everybody would notice what you're saying. But in this psalm, there's a big change. In the beginning, God is third person. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. But when it gets darkest, when you can't see beyond the shadow, God is closest. And the psalmist says, you. I will fear no evil, for you are with me. God is closer in that darkest time until you can see that light, and then you realize all along that the dark was just something that just kept you from seeing. This is a song you know the words to. So I invite you to say it with me. I'm using the old King James Version, though it was written long before English was in the original Hebrew, but that wouldn't make sense to any of us. So you know the words. Say it with me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let us pray. God, in this life, we give you thanks for those who are larger than life, so that we can go back into our lives and be large. We thank you for those who bring a song for each of us so that we may go and share our songs with others. We thank you for those who fully live out the life that they are given so that we might fully live out our lives and make room for so many others to do the same. Because then the party gets bigger. And that's what you wanted for us from the beginning. And that's why you send us the artist, so that we might live out your dream for the world and might share not just your amazing grace with one another, but that amazing love. Amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a
Please sing with us.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Friends, there's a journey ahead of each of us. And the good news is you don't walk it alone. That when the time seems darkest, God will be near us. And there will be those who can see far enough to let us know what's over the rainbow and what's through the valley of the shadow. So that we know that the life God has for us is bigger than whatever death can dream of for us. That the light is much bigger than the darkness. And the music on the other side, well, it will be amazing. Go from this place and on your way, may the Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you and give you peace now and forevermore. Amen and amen.